8/2021. This is Juan Sound City Council. We're starting just a minute late while we're dealing with all the online connections. Tonight we started at 6 p.m. in closed session. Both the closed and open sessions are being conducted with electronic participation due to the emergency declaration made by the province. Joining us in council chambers is Councillor Hamley and Councillor Koepke, city manager, city clerk, and deputy clerk. All other council and staff members are joining us via video. Those of us in council chambers completed a screening form, are appropriately distanced, and are wearing masks for additional protection. I would like to remind those who are joining the meeting from home to keep your microphones on mute unless you're speaking. When a council or staff member wishes to speak, please speak up and introduce yourself so those listening know who is speaking. For each vote, I will ask councillors whether they are in favor or opposed so that those at home can hear how each member is voting. Unless a recorded vote is requested, each person's votes will not be recorded in the minutes. For any councillor present through video that declares a pecuniary interest, the clerk will place you in a virtual lobby during discussion of the item and readmit you to the meeting at the appropriate time. So with that, I think I'm down to number four on our agenda, calling for additional business, going to staff first. Any staff members first that have additional business? Dennis?
Your Worship, it's Dennis Kefalis, Director of Public Works and Engineering. I'd like just to be able to speak about the snow removal winter control operations during this past weekend.
Great, thank you. Any other staff? Not seeing any. Councillors? Councillor Merton?
Through your worship, I'd like to give a brief update on my attendance at the virtual Roma conference.
Okay. Is there anyone else, councillors? Just going on the screen first. Okay, Councillor Koepke.
Thank you, Worship. Just some information about Snow and Sound event.
Okay, and I'll have four items on current events ongoing with the city right now. Sorry, I'm just going to go on hold here for a second. We're because we've been 3 weeks, I'm kind of sloppy and not in form. I skipped number three on the agenda. I did the opening statement, but didn't do number three, which was reporting at a closed session. So during the closed session, council reviewed minutes from the closed session meeting of council held on January 18th, 2021. Council discussed one matter regarding personal matters about an identifiable individual respecting board, committee, or public appointments. Direction was provided to staff. Council also discussed one matter regarding personal matters about an identifiable individual, including municipal employees, labor relations, or employee negotiations, and advice that is subject to a solicitor-client privilege, including communications necessary for that purpose respecting a city position. No direction was given. So I've gone through four, so now I'm down to number five, declaration of interest. Does any councillor have an interest they wish to declare? Seeing none. Number six, confirmation of minutes.
Moved by myself, seconded by Councillor Koepke, that the minutes of the closed session of the regular council meeting held on January 18th, 2021, as printed, be adopted.
Thank you. In favor or opposed, Councillor Dodd? Councillor Gregg?
In favor.
Councillor Hamley?
In favor.
Councillor Koepke?
In favor.
Councillor Merton?
In favor.
Deputy Mayor O'Leary?
In favor.
Councillor Tamming?
In favor.
Councillor Thomas?
In favor.
So that is carried. Next motion.
Moved by myself, seconded by Councillor Kepke, that the minutes of the regular council meeting held on January 18th, 2021, as printed, be adopted.
And again, Councillor Dodd.
For.
Councillor Gregg.
In favor.
Councillor Hamley.
In favor.
Councillor Kepke.
In favor.
Councillor Merton.
In favor.
Deputy Mayor O'Leary.
In favor.
Councillor Tamming.
In favor.
Councillor Thomas.
In favor.
So that is carried. Thank you. Number seven.
Moved by myself, seconded by Councillor Kepke, that City Council now move into Committee of the Whole to consider public meetings, deputations, and presentations, public question period, matters arising from correspondence, reports of city staff, consent agenda, committee minutes, matters postponed, motions for which notice was previously given, and additional business.
Great, thank you. Again, I'll call the question. Councillor Dodd.
In favor.
Councillor Gregg.
In favor.
Councillor Hamley.
In favor.
Councillor Kepke.
In favor.
Councillor Merton.
In favor.
Deputy Mayor O'Leary.
In favor.
Councillor Tamming.
In favor.
Councillor Thomas.
In favor.
So that is carried. So we're now in Committee of the Whole. At 8A, we have a zoning bylaw amendment, number 32 for Sydenham Campus. So first of all, I declare the meeting open. I would like to remind everyone that the purpose of the public meeting is to receive input from the public. Every person who attends a statutory public meeting required under the Planning Act shall be given an opportunity to make representations in respect of the proposed bylaw. All submission materials for this application are available on the city's website, so owensound.ca, and at the Planning Division, City Hall, during regular business hours. If a person or public body would otherwise have an ability to appeal the decision of the City of Owen Sound to the local planning appeal tribunal, but the person or public body does not make oral submissions at a public meeting or make written submissions to the City of Owen Sound before the zoning bylaw amendment is passed, person or public body is not entitled to appeal the decision. If a person or public body does not make oral submissions at a public meeting or make written submissions to the City of Owen Sound before the zoning bylaw amendment is passed, the person or public body may not be added as a party to the hearing of an appeal for the local planning appeal tribunal unless, in the opinion of the tribunal, there are reasonable grounds for doing so. Passing it to Ms. Bloomfield.
Thank you, Your Worship. Notice that this public meeting was circulated to the prescribed bodies, posted on the city's website, and published in the Sun Times on January 19th. The comments that have been received were included in the agenda package. The personal information collected at this public meeting is collected under the authority of the Planning Act and the Municipal Freedom of Information and Protection of Privacy Act. The information collected will be used to complete the zoning bylaw amendment process and will form part of the public record. Questions about this collection should be addressed to myself, the city clerk. If you wish to be notified of the decision of the Corporation of the City of Owen Sound on the proposed zoning bylaw amendment, you must make a written request to the City of Owen Sound, care of myself, the city clerk.
So next, we have a presentation from the Manager of Planning and Heritage. Ms. Cann, welcome.
Good evening. Thank you very much. Take this off. Thank you, and good evening, members of council, staff, and members of the public. So we are here this evening to hold a public meeting to gain input regarding zoning amendment number 32. for the proposed redevelopment of the former Sydenham Community School as an innovation center by the County of Gray. Here we have a key map showing the location of the former Sydenham Community School on 8th Street East. This ortho photo shows the surrounding land uses, which are predominated by low density residential neighborhoods to the west and north. Georgian College is located to the east. Light industrial and future residential and arterial commercial lands are existing or planned to the south. The area subject to rezoning includes the entire parcel, which contains the one-story, roughly 4,000 square meter building. The existing site has two entrances from 8th Street East, two parking areas, and extensive green space at the northern end of the parcel. The subject lands are designated institutional in the city's official plan. The institutional designation is intended for public and private institutions and permits a wide range of institutional type uses. Public uses can include government services such as research establishments, provided they're compatible with surrounding land uses. The subject lands are zoned institutional. Permitted uses in the institutional zone include a wide range of uses, including schools and public uses. The city has received a complete application for zoning bylaw amendment number 32 and also for site plan approval. The applications are being processed concurrently. So master site plan approval is being requested for use and development of the site in two phases. This slide shows phase two with minor modification to the parking area. So this is just really an information slide, as site plan approval is not considered part of this public meeting. The purpose of the application is to permit a county-owned and managed research and development facility or innovation center in the former Sydenham School. The effect of the application is to add and define a research and development facility as a permitted use on the subject property. The application also proposes a site-specific off-street parking requirement that will apply to any mix or combination of users within the building that form the research and development facility. The applicant has submitted complete rezoning and site plan approval applications with all of the required supporting plans and studies included. So the process for the zoning bylaw amendment so far began November 25th with submission of complete application and fees along with those submission materials. December 16th, we had a letter of complete application go out to our applicant. December 18th, we had our notice of complete application go out, and also a request to city staff and agency for comments was also sent. January 18th, Council considered a technical report from planning staff. Public meeting was given. January 26th, our site plan review was undertaken by our Accessibility Advisory Committee. So notices of complete application and public meeting, as the clerk noted, were given separately in the Sun-Times newspaper, and a courtesy mailing was issued to owners within 120 meters of the subject property. Final review and consideration of public comments will go forward to inform everything we receive.
Has joined the meeting.
At the public meeting. Going forward to March 1st, we anticipate our zoning amendment and site plan approval recommendation report will come forward to council. March 15th, we anticipate the enacting bylaw to come forward. And then March 29th, our bylaw to authorize our site plan agreement, we anticipate on that date. So comments from the public received to date, and we have received a few, have been attached to your council agenda for consideration. And comments received from the public, agencies, and staff will be reviewed and considered in the recommendation report, which again is tentatively scheduled to come forward on March 1st. With that, I'll conclude, and I'm happy to answer any questions you may have. And as you know, the County of Gray, being the applicant, is in virtual attendance and is prepared to prepared with a brief presentation on the nature of the proposed research and development facility. Thank you.
Great. Thank you very much. I don't think we'll have any questions just yet. We'll go to the county representative, and I'm not sure who it is. It is Scott Taylor. Oh, there we go. Hi, Scott. Welcome.
Thank you, Mayor Boddy, members of council. I'm actually going to turn it over to Savannah Myers here. I'm just kind of running the slideshow for the beginning, and she'll take you through the first part, and I'll talk about some of the planning aspects later on. So, Savannah?
Sounds good. Thanks, Scott. Good evening, council. Thank you for having us tonight to talk to you about Sydenham campus. This has been a long time coming to get to this stage. Scott, if you can flip it to the very first slide, that would be perfect. If you have control, I'm not sure. We can't see the slides on here. I can see Scott and people.
Welcome to the 90s, eh?
As long as you can let us know, can you see the background slide?
No, we're just seeing.
Scott, did you want me to try to bring it up, or are you still trying?
You're muted, Scott.
Sorry, I'll try one more time here. My apologies. Can people see that now?
Yes, we can.
Perfect. Okay, so we'll start with a little bit of background. 2017, that's when this project kicked off the ground. That really came after 2 full years of Employer One surveys coming back telling us that 68% of our work and our employers were having a really tough time finding people. It was fair to poor in terms of the labor shortage. That continued on for a third year. And then in 2018, it jumped to 77%. And in 2019, it jumped to 83%. So we have not been heading in the right direction, which reinforces, you know, exactly why we're looking at doing this. This was also coupled with the same time as the announcement of the Bruce Power major component replacement and looking at the growth there. And we started to see numbers of the types of employees and the number of employees they were going to need. And that really worried us about what it was going to do to our local labor force. So that was the second piece. And then at the same time, the third piece to it was that Georgian College was running out of space and they were looking for opportunities to expand and grow so that they weren't locked by the space that they had to be able to go after those opportunities. So it was kind of a perfect storm of three different pieces that came together in 2017. So we put together a business plan in the summer of 2018. We had partners join forces, which included the City of Owen Sound. So Gray County, Georgian College, both school boards and the City of Owen Sound joined together, met with over 100 stakeholders to talk about what it was that we could do to help make a difference and solve problems for the labor force today and going forward. And in October of 2018, we purchased the former Sydenham School, which we've now named Sydenham Campus, because Regional Skills Training, Trades and Innovation Center was a real mouthful. And just too much to communicate each and every time. So if you flip it to the next slide, Scott, we just wanted to reinforce the location. I know that Amy has just showed you that, but this is really why we looked at this property and this opportunity at the time we did. No other time would we have had the opportunity to find such a great property right beside Georgian College where the synergies could be met right away. And that is why this location became the home for what will become Sydenham campus as we move forward. It is sitting on 10 acres, just over 44,000 square feet. So there's a lot of potential there. And like we said, because we only have a fence separating us from Georgian College, it became the perfect location to start to focus on. So I'm gonna hand it over to Steve, which I think he's got audio now. And he's going to talk to you about the purpose and kind of where we are today and the work that's been done. I think, Steve, you're muted. Not working for him to come off. Okay, that's okay. I'll talk to you about purpose then and where we are today. So like I said, the Regional Skills Training Trades and Innovation Center The focus is really to support our small businesses through incubation, through research and prototyping, and through the skills training and trades development, because workforce is just as important as supporting our entrepreneurship community. We had an initial proposed users of Business Enterprise Center, which, as you know, is part of Grey County Economic Development now. Catapult, Business Accelerator, which is looking at that next stage of entrepreneurship and the scaling of business. Community Futures Development Corporation, to bring all of the services into one location. So you really truly become a one-stop shop for business. Hot desks and internet access collaboration space, as we know, all accelerators, incubators, it doesn't matter what term you call them, that is really the collision space where we see good things happen and where we bring entrepreneurs together under one roof. On the skills training side, the fabrication labs were something that really came loud and clear through those community consultations.
Savannah, we've lost your vocals. Savannah, we've lost your vocals. We're not hearing you. Yeah.
It's Scott here. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, maybe the third person will be a charm. We'll see. I won't do it justice like Steve and Savannah would, but I'll try to keep going through this. So I think Savannah covered a lot of the uses proposed or some of the proposed uses before we lost audio there. But the key is it really is going to be a community use, and there'll be a number of different tenants there, but they're all driving towards a central vision, which is a vision that should benefit the city of Owen Sound and the county of Grey as a whole. Originally back in sort of the business planning days, we put together a concept that looked like this, where you had a proposed childcare wing that was going to be in the former kindergarten area of the former Sydenham School. There was going to be the post-secondary wing, which we were hoping to collaborate with Georgian College on. There'd be an innovation center down towards 8th Street, and the existing gym and some of the other facilities would have been the community and flex space. Where we could hold events and offer training sessions and various other things in that regard. With respect to the business plan, the overall business plan, of course, the goal is cost recovery. The three central tenants that we're looking at, and not all of them have signed on yet per se, but are the Small Business Enterprise Center, as Savannah mentioned, Georgian College, and potentially in the future, a childcare or children's services tenant. The county has set competitive lease rates on this. The intent was to foster business and to offer training, but it certainly wasn't meant in any way to compete with other commercial landlords or landlords that are offering office space for rent. So it's not free space by any means to any of the tenants. We've set a lease rate at $12 per square foot gross. And the objective is that any tenant within the building has to be giving back to Sydenham campus as well. So it might be that they're collaborating with other businesses or tenants in the building. Could be that they're offering training. It could be that they're using shared equipment with other businesses. Or it could be that they're in there for mentorship purposes. And so they're there to learn. They're there to kind of get their feet as a business. And then hopefully grow and rent or own space elsewhere in the city or the county. To date, the county has invested quite a large amount of money between the purchase of the building and some of the interior renovations that have been done. It's been over $1.4 million at this stage. You've actually seen some of the renovations so far in the pictures just on the side of your screen, but one of the key ones was improving the roof. We've made some accessibility requirements. So the main entrance to what was the former school and now Sydenham campus is now completely accessible. We've upgraded a number of rooms. There's been transforming it into a space that tenants and the community will be pleased to enter and is truly accessible for all users and visitors to the campus. And if we weren't in pandemic times, we'd certainly love to take both community members and city council on tour of the space, but that'll just have to wait till another time at this stage. As Savannah mentioned, in total, we do have over 44,000 square feet here, which is made up of the former classrooms, the office space, and the former gym space in that regard. With respect to the proposed planning applications, as Amy mentioned in her presentation, the current zoning is institutional, and I would note that the institutional zone provides a number of uses, not just the former school, but it includes things like community centers or clinics or studios, public uses. It would even include a studio residence. And in sitting down and speaking with city planning staff early in the process, we thought a lot of what we wanted to do through the Sydenham campus was captured through some of the permitted uses already on the site in terms of community centers and studios and such. But city staff made a great suggestion, and they thought maybe we should look at a zoning amendment to really define the use exactly as we see it transforming, and also to redefine the parking requirements on site. Currently, a number of those institutional uses have different parking requirements, and what the county is proposing through this zoning amendment would be that it would require 3 parking spaces per 100 square meters, not including the hallway space, which can't be used for usable space in that regard. So our intent is to reuse the former Sydenham School, as Savannah mentioned, both because of the synergies with Georgian College, but also because of other locational factors. It is on a transit route. There are bike paths and sidewalks in the area, and it is nearby to other businesses and residents. So we really did feel it was the ideal location in this regard. We have broken the second here. Should note that in phase one, there's absolutely no further exterior changes proposed at this stage. So we're not proposing to take down any vegetation, to change the parking lot in any way. It's simply going to look and function like the old school did in that regard. And I'll just move on to the current concept plan here. And this defines phase one and two. So what you see in sort of the orangey yellow color there is the phase one. And you can see it does encompass a good portion of the former school site. So we have the library, we have the former administration offices, the gym, and the kindergarten wing. And phase two is some of the additional classroom spaces. And the key distinction between phase one and phase two really relates to the parking. So within phase one, again, that yellowy-orange color, we're going to have 75 existing parking spaces, as well as 4 barrier-free spaces. And that's the parking you find at the existing Sydenham campus or the former school. Before going into phase two, the county is going to have to improve the parking to add some more spaces based on the amount of square footage we have in the school. And you can actually see that just on the next map here. So this is the phase two site plan, and what you'll see is the existing building, but immediately abutting sort of the west wing of the building, you'll see a series of new parking spaces there. The county won't be paving any new areas on site, but we'll simply be taking out some of that existing wide sidewalk to put in those parking spaces. The wide sidewalk was, of course, there because you had a primary school and buses unloading, and it was there for safety purposes, but it's certainly not needed for a use of this nature. There'll still be walkways and sidewalks, so we're not sacrificing walkability or safety in that regard. And I should reiterate that even as part of phase two, even as part of this modification to the parking lot, we're not going to be taking down any of the trees or the vegetation on site. So the existing trees on site will stay, and there's no proposal to remove them at this time. I should note the other thing we'll be adding here, which I should have mentioned almost first and foremost, is there'll be bicycle parking added to the site as well, which is very important for some of our users to get to and from the site, of course. With respect to what's been done today, Amy mentioned, and they were in your agenda package, that there have been some comments received. We just wanted to take some time now and hopefully answer some of those questions to any of the neighbors that might have written those comments and might be tuning in here with us tonight. One of the key questions was, what type of research will be done in this facility? In this regard, it could range from economic research to scientific research to even agricultural research. But the key will be that most of it will be data or paper based. So we're not looking at uses in here that would necessarily generate any noise or odors to the neighbors. Furthermore, even beyond protecting the neighbors in that regard, there's going to be a variety of different tenants in the building. So we certainly don't want to have, you know, for lack of a better word, one noisy or noxious neighbor, or one noisy or noxious tenant, I'm sorry, that's going to be causing a disruption to the other users in the building. We would anticipate that once this building is fully up and running, there'll actually be less noise here than there was when it was an elementary school, and we're certainly not anticipating school bells or noisy recesses as the neighbors might have noticed before. In this regard, perhaps some of the noise levels would be similar to the types of noises that Georgian College might be generating in that regard. With respect to the parking situation, obviously I've highlighted that we're going to be adding some more parking, but there were some comments and questions raised, and rightfully so, from neighbors about what type of traffic we might be expecting here. And we anticipate that actually the daily traffic will be less than what was at the former school, especially during those busy pickup and drop off times. So we fully anticipate that the parking provided will cover it, and people won't need to be parking on neighboring streets or in neighboring lots in that regard. There could such as a job fair or a training session, which may require additional parking. And I would equate this similar to the way the school used to have, say, their Christmas concert or fall fair. So there's the odd time where there might be additional parking needed. He says it's our hope to schedule these events at off hours, so we're not competing with some of the other uses, and potentially partner with our neighbors at Georgian College to see if part of their parking lot could be used for some of that overflow traffic. But I have to reiterate that most of the parking on a day-to-day basis will be completely contained in the lots, and there'll be no need for additional parking. One of the other questions was with respect to parking enforcement and whether or not there'd be paid parking. Obviously, we know in this strip of the city, there's Georgian College that has paid parking, and further down, there's the hospital. At this stage, it's not our intent to charge for parking. If parking becomes an issue or we're having an issue with many college students choosing to park at this location when they're not a tenant at the college, we might have to look at paid parking in the future, but at this stage, we're hoping to go through a mixture of education and sort of gentle warnings on site.
Like we lost Scott.
As I said, there could be occasional events needed that might happen in the early evening or on a weekend. I should also note that some of those uses in the future, some of those events might use some of the outdoor space, or if we ever get into a situation of having childcare, we might have a playground or play yard outside for children in that regard. As I said, we're not anticipating large numbers of people here. One of the other questions we had was with respect to future plans for the site. Are there going to be any new buildings on site or any additions on site? At this stage, the answer is no. We have no plans to add on to the existing school building or build any new buildings. That said, should future opportunities arise, we might explore future additions or buildings in that regard. But any future changes to the site would need to A, conform to the city zoning bylaw, and B, they would need to be consistent with the site plan should it get approved for this property. So city staff will have further control there over any future use that that goes on the site in this regard. At this stage, that's my presentation, or I should say Savannah and Steve and I's presentation. I apologize for the technical difficulties, and we'd certainly be happy to take any questions from either City Council or members of the public joining us today. Or if there are people tuning in at home that wish to contact any one of us, our contact information is up on the screen there. So thank you very much for your time and consideration this evening.
Thank you very much, Mr. Taylor and Ms. Myers and Mr. Furness. That was well presented by Scott. I think from there we, Ms. Bloomfield, do we have anyone that is registered to participate?
Thank you, Your Worship. Those wishing to speak at tonight's public meeting were to register by January 29th. Brian and Maria Jones were the only ones that registered, and they've joined us via WebEx this evening.
Great. So if we can go to Brian and Maria Jones, ask, well, I guess we just provided your name for you, municipality where you reside, and limit your comments to 5 minutes, and we'd love to hear from you.
Hello, it's Maria, and Brian's here with me. We live on 11th Avenue in our backyard, backs onto the Sydenham School, the Sydenham campus, and we're happy to have the campus there. They've been there for a bit now, and there haven't been any issues. But for those who've been on council for a bit, they'll know that we have had parking issues on the street, particularly from Georgian College of students that didn't want to pay paid parking. So they've put in some signs. The city council was really good to get some signs up and limited the parking. But I see the sign at Sydenham already telling Georgian College students to park over at Georgian College. So I foresee that the campus, the Sydenham campus, will have a problem with Georgian College students camping, parking in their parking spots, and just kind of like making the problem come back again. And if they put up paid parking, then we're going to see the increased traffic flow. So I don't know, when you're considering parking, gated parking or whatever you'll eventually do to keep unpaid people out of there, that you consider making it part of your rental fee so that those people would have passes so they could have access to that without having to pay, because people will find places to park that they don't have to pay. So I think that's one of our biggest things, because again, 11th Avenue doesn't have sidewalks. It's a narrower street than the other avenues around, and it just really gets congested, even with the parents from East Ridge coming up and down the avenue and dropping kids off at school. So it just gets really, really busy, and there's lots of kids on the road. So that's really, I think, really, and we're glad to hear the properties, the trees are gonna stay generally the way it is. So we're happy with that, and thanks for letting us speak.
Great, thanks, Maria. Any counselor, any questions for Ms. Jones? Not seeing any hands going up. So again, we appreciate your feedback. Thank you. Ms. Bloomfield, was there anyone else? No, those are the only ones. So with that, I think we've heard from the public, we've heard from the applicant, we've heard from our manager. So I think that concludes everything. So with that, I will declare this public meeting closed. Thanks to everyone who has presented and spoken. Thank you.
Hi, it's Carol Merton, and I'm not able to hear anything. Is that going on for the others as well? And you're hearing it, so what should I do?
She should call.
Yeah, and I've been hearing it up until
we can hear you, Carol.
Councilor Merton, are you able to use the call-in number to connect to the meeting?
No. And I was hearing everything. So my camera came on. Yeah. And I don't know why I can't.
Ms. Merton, you might be on the telephone with your microphone on. I'll ask you to turn your microphone off. The private one.
Hold on. I'm not very good at all of this setting stuff, I have to tell you.
Yeah, I've muted her.
Okay. Next on the agenda is 8B, which is the official plan amendment number 10. Official plan update. I would like to remind everyone that the purpose of this public meeting is also to receive input from the public. This is the first of two public meetings to discuss the official plan. Council will be holding a special council meeting on March 15th, 2021 from 1 p.m. to 4 p.m. specifically to discuss the official plan. Every person who attends a statutory public meeting required under the Planning Act shall be given an opportunity to make representations in respect of the proposed bylaw. Copy of the proposed official plan is available on the city's website and at the Planning Division at City Hall during regular business hours. If a person or public body would otherwise have an ability to appeal the decision of the City of Owen Sound to the Local Planning Appeal Tribunal, but the person or public body does not make oral submissions at the public meeting or make written submissions to the City of Owen Sound before the proposed official plan amendment is adopted, the person or the public body is not entitled to appeal the decision. If a person or public body does not make oral submissions at a public meeting or make written
has left the meeting
or make written submissions to the City of Owen Sound before the proposed official plan amendment is adopted, the person or public body may not be added as a party to the hearing of the appeal before the local planning planning appeal tribunal, unless in the opinion of the tribunal, there are reasonable grounds for doing so. So with that, I pass it over to Ms. Bloomfield.
Thank you, Your Worship. Notice of this public meeting was circulated to the prescribed bodies, posted on the city's website, and published in the Sun-Times on December 29th and January 8th. The comments that have been received were included in the agenda package, except for one which was circulated this morning. It was comments from Gray County, and they will be available on the agenda when it is republished tomorrow. The personal information collected at this public meeting is collected under the authority of the Planning Act and the Municipal Freedom of Information and Protection of Privacy Act. The information collected will be used to complete the official plan amendment process and will form part of the public record. Questions about this collection should be addressed to myself, the city clerk. If you wish to be notified of the decision of the Corporation of the City of Owen Sound on the official plan amendment, you must make a written request to the City of Owen Sound care of the city clerk.
Yes. Thank you. So I think next we're hearing from a presentation from David Aston of MHBC Planning. All right, there we go. Welcome, David.
Good evening, Mayor and members of council. Thanks for the opportunity to be here this evening. I just want to start off by saying we're excited to be to this point in the official plan review process. This point has been really a combination of a lot of collaboration with myself and Liam Murphy, who's on the phone on the meeting tonight with me, a planner from our office, and a number of city staff, including Pam and Amy and everyone in other departments that have provided comment on the draft official plan. So we're very thankful for all of the input that's being received through the process. Also want to acknowledge the various public comments that have been received, both written and verbal, as part of the open house that we held recently. That information has all been combined into a table, and we're tracking the comments and thankful for the input that's being received. It's been very coordinated and professional, and so we're here tonight with the public meeting to continue to move this forward. And I'm just figuring out how to move the slide. There we go. So the public meeting this evening is, again, providing opportunity for the public to provide comments and input on the draft official plan that's been posted. As I mentioned, we have received input. We're working through that input, and later on in the presentation, I'll give a bit of an overview on some of the responses that we're considering to the public comments received to date. And This evening, we just also wanted to respond to any questions of council as we move forward to the next meeting, at which point we'll have most likely some recommended modifications to the official plan as part of a technical report. So the official plan update was needed based on a variety of reasons. One is to update the plan, seeing that it was last adopted in 2006, review and ensure consistency with provincial policy with the new policy statement in 2020, assess conformity with other applicable planning policies, and also implement recommendations from other studies that have been adopted by the city, other master plans and studies. An example here is a retail and commercial policy review report, and recreation master plan is another example. So the official plan is a guiding document that's going to include policy direction associated with findings of these city studies. And it is one of the tools to assist in decisions on land use planning. And I want to just make a quick note of that as it relates to some of the public comments. The official plan, as I mentioned, is one tool related to decision making associated with land use decisions or planning application decisions, and pulls in policies and direction from various different elements associated with the city. There are other plans and bylaws that also implement the strategic direction of the city and council. And so this official plan is one component of the bigger picture policy framework and set of directions that council would utilize in making decisions. So I want to clarify that because there are various comments that I believe are looking for the official plan to be the only document that provides direction on future decision making. And while it's important and critical, there are other documents that will guide decisions of the city. So at this point, we're in what we call the last phase, or phase four, of finalizing the official plan. We'll be receiving the comments this evening. Any other comments that are received up until the final draft of the official plan. As was mentioned, we received the county comments today, and we anticipate the other technical agency comments soon. Public consultation, there's been a number of steps, the community engagement sessions, the online tools have been great. We've been receiving a lot of information and input through the city's website after the discussion papers and the draft official plan were posted. So we're continuing with that and encourage people to continue to monitor on the city's website under the official plan section for information and updates. The discussion papers that led to the development of the draft official plan included sustainability and climate change, housing and affordability, transportation and infrastructure, land use and design. And each of these looked at different aspects, existing policy conditions, examples of best practices in other areas, did an analysis as it relates to provincial policy statement and county official plan, and provided some proposed recommendations for the draft official plan. And those were incorporated into the draft official plan. One of the key elements that we found in reviewing the official plan and through the visioning exercises and input was that there wasn't a clear vision statement in the official plan for the city. So through the visioning sessions and information received from the online survey and other public comments, we established a vision statement for the official plan. And this is the vision statement here that we're proposing in the official plan. And looking for it to provide recognition of the city's unique area, natural environment, cultural diversity, history, the waterfront, and ensure that we consider sustainability, resiliency, and quality of life. So the sustainability and climate change, as you review the draft official plan, you would see that there's new policies introduced to address and respond to a changing climate, policies and support sustainable transportation options, active transit, electric vehicle charging stations, support for low impact and energy efficient developments, and providing a more clear policy for supporting living streets with an active transportation focus. So examples of these policies are found throughout the plan in an infrastructure section or an urban design section or transportation section. So there's updates throughout the entire plan. Housing affordability, looked at additional dwelling units and looked to simplify those as potential for additional forms of housing. Encourage a balance of low, medium, and high density residential uses. Provided some additional direction and policy support for daycare centers and group homes. And strengthened affordable and rental housing policy direction. So an example here is a policy related to condominium conversions from rental housing is now included in the city's official plan. On density, we reviewed recent applications in the city related to density, official plan amendments and zoning bylaw amendments, and identified areas where consideration could be given to higher densities, with specific criteria as to consideration for the higher density. And that was in a direct response to, we were finding that areas in kind of key nodes in the city that were already considered higher density areas, densities were being requested to be increased. So we looked at that as the criteria. Transportation infrastructure, introduced policies to support infrastructure needs for capital projects, different funding, grants, incentives, so policies that would support those considerations, support for and promote active transit infrastructure, policies related to connectivity of high-speed internet, and policies supporting the efficient use of existing transportation and infrastructure systems for development. So this was really integrating the city's engineering and design standards and considerations, and finding the integration of official plan policy with those design considerations. Land use and design, as I mentioned, we looked at the density targets. One of the changes was naming of land use areas within the city to conform to current strategies. For example, the downtown district is renamed in the official plan to River District. Provided further direction on parkland dedication and the collection of cash in lieu in plans of subdivision and site plans, and the approach to parkland dedication and provision for parkland dedication bylaw considerations, and then introduce policies to support safety and security through development design. So these were principles established and included into the urban design section. So next steps is to update the official plan and bring the document, which, well, this is really what we did with the official plan. is we provided the draft in accordance with the terms of reference, looking to bring the policy into conformity with provincial and county policies, and adding or amending policies that were in the official plan previously to provide appropriate balance and direction for future land use and sustainability. So public comments that we've received to date, this is from a high-level summary of what we've seen through letters submitted and comments through the open house. Greater policy direction needed in relation to climate change and incorporation of a climate action plan. Looking to include climate change in design sections associated with quality of life and infrastructure. Language associated with sustainable action. Look at the verbs and the city, you know, rather than promoting or encouraging, are there areas where the city, where we'll use words such as will or shall or require. Density and sustainable community and impacts of intensification was a comment. There was support for intensification and the alternative dwelling unit types that were proposed. Questions regarding waste management technology. Comment that the official plan should continue to maintain the cultural heritage policies. There were specific comments from property owners related to properties, and then a request for confirmation on timing for council consideration. So there was a lot of comment where the public was thinking that a decision was being made this evening on the official plan, so we clarified the process. So in response to some of these, we've been giving some thought to modifications and looking in at the climate changes and sustainability comments, and looking to modify the objectives and provide a clear objective related to sustainability and climate change, rather than it being an objective that, you know, is combined in an environmental objective, to pull this as a clear objective of the official plan. And we're looking at introducing a new climate change section that would provide policy support for the development of a climate action plan and policy support for city and our county targets that could be established through a climate action plan. Waste management, the group, the Waste Watchers group provided some good input on updated policy language as it relates to the different types of wastes and how those are handled. So reviewing their comments, and again, I think they had some very good comments that we'll look to incorporate. And then with regard to comments on tree protection, we'll be ensuring that there's a policy basis for completion of tree management plans, and as may be required through site plan or design process or plan of subdivision, appropriate tree compensation and management as part of those processes. So next steps. This is a slide from the public open house. You'll see we're at the public meeting this evening already. We are in process of preparing a technical report that will include some proposed modifications that will be considered at the special meeting of council March 15th. From there, we'll finalize the official plan and prepare a recommendation report for council consideration and adoption of a new official plan. And then based on that, the final plan is forwarded to the county for final review and approval. And as far as continued involvement and engagement, as I mentioned, the best spot at this point is to continue to review any updates on the city's website with a specific link to the official plan, All of the documents and presentations are available on the city's website. And that is my presentation for this evening. Thank you.
Great. Thank you very much, Mr. Aston. This is now our chance to hear comments from the public, if any. Ms. Bloomfield, did we receive any registrations for this part?
Thank you, Your Worship. Those wishing to speak at tonight's public meeting were to register by January 29th. Both Peter Middleton and Shauna McIver were the two individuals that registered. Now, I did see Peter on earlier, but it looks like he's no longer there. So last I saw, Shauna was still here.
Okay, so Ms. McIver, if you're there, feel free to go ahead. Welcome. Okay, you do. We're giving you 5 minutes, of course, you already knew that. And ask you to provide your name and municipality. Thanks.
Right. Go ahead. Thank you very much, and good evening, everyone. My name is Shauna McIver. I live at Balmy Beach Road, just outside of Owen Sound. And I'm standing in for Lloyd Lewis, who is the head of Neighborhoods North. He can't be with us tonight. We have 4 points to make. I hope I can make them in less than 5 minutes with regard to the official plan. These points have to do with key dates and timing, with conformity with other plans that Dave Aston just talked about. With the third point is to do with an environmental advisory committee. And the fourth point has to do with urban forest protection and expansion. So those are the 4 points I'll make. And I'll start with key dates. This year, 2021, the council will approve the Owen Sound official plan, and this plan will extend over a 25-year horizon. This takes us to 2046. That's 4 years short of Canada's goal of a net zero emissions by 2050. Why 2050? Well, as you know, according to the latest available science, if we're to limit warming across the globe to around 1.5 degrees, then global greenhouse gas emissions need to peak by 2020, that's last year, and reduce to zero by 2050. Of course, to achieve that goal, we have to start now, yesterday, last year, long ago. Another point about timing, to just a quick point, is that we're told that younger voters are much more green than their elders. Of course they are. It's their life that they are facing. The official plan being shaped now will play out during the lifetimes of these voters. So that's my first point, key dates, key timing. Second point, conformity with provincial plans and the County of Grey. As Dave just said, there is an intention to conform with provincial and county policies. In our view, the first draft we saw didn't correspond with these overarching documents in an important way. Both the province and the county recognize climate change as a problem requiring widespread action. In its Planning Act, the Ontario government requires municipalities to address climate change by planning for more efficient and sustainable communities. Closer to home, Grey County is developing a climate change action plan. I was glad to hear Dave say the city may now be thinking about that. From the version published by the county on their website 2 weeks ago, I want to quote the first sentence in the vision statement. That sentence reads, "The County of Grey is a clear and visible climate leader, taking actions to address climate change throughout municipal operations and the community." Owen Sound's plan should clearly reflect this context. Our third point, this has to do with an environmental advisory committee. I know that the city already has an environmental committee. We're wanting to see something that is broadly based and that draws on the expertise that Owen Sound and its surrounding area has, both from those who have lived here for a long time and new retirees to the area. There's a lot of expertise here. Peter Middleton, I'm sorry if he's not going to speak tonight, he's an example of this kind of expertise. As with most municipalities, our city hall in Owen Sound is cash strapped, I'm sure you'd agree, and there is a shortage of staff to do everything that needs to be done. Councillors can't know everything, nor can city officials. They simply haven't got the time or sometimes the deep expertise required to consider all the angles in complex issues such as land development. An environmental committee that has real push and broad representation would promote cooperation and harmony between the city and its residents and the surrounding area. It could draw volunteers from excellent organizations that we have here, including, I'll just name a few as examples, the Grey Sauble Conservation Authority, the Owen Sound Climate Action Team, and the various action teams in the townships around Owen Sound, Neighborwoods North, the Owen Sound Waste Watchers that Dave referred to, the Drinking Water Source Protection Committee, the Owen Sound Field Naturalists, I could go on. There are a number of groups with real expertise. We're hoping that those can be, can form, representatives from those kinds of groups can form a real helpful environmental advisory committee for the city. My last and fourth point has to do with what we need to, in the official plan to protect and expand the urban tree canopy. I don't need to tell you that trees have a well-researched beneficial impact on physical and mental health. They also increase biodiversity, they take up carbon, they help with flood control, drought mitigation, cooling surfaces, and so on, the list goes on, and all this at relatively low cost. Trees are a key tool. Owen Sound has an impressive natural heritage. Its official plan needs to make explicit how the city will work with the community and surrounding townships to protect, expand, and care for our natural spaces and tree canopy. I know that's the intention, but it needs to be explicit. Specifically, the city needs a separate budget for trees, an environmental advisory committee, as I just mentioned, a tree baseline survey so that we know where we are to start with, goals for future plantings, and updated bylaws to protect what we have. There is enthusiasm for this approach. I mentioned Lloyd Lewis. There are hundreds of volunteers led by Lloyd and Gord Edwards have planted more than 4,000 trees and are creating an 8-acre naturalized forest of healing up at the hospital grounds. This is a remarkable achievement, and it shows the enthusiasm in this community. Other opportunities exist. Owen Sound could join other Ontario cities, including Guelph, Whitby, Mississauga, Thunder Bay, Toronto, and others whose applications are in process, to be recognized as a tree city of the world. We will be bringing more to the council more on this at a later date. Meantime, let's ensure that the official plan has clear goals and monitoring targets to protect and expand our tree canopy. Thank you for taking these 4 points into consideration on your next version of the official plan.
Great. Were there others? Appears to be no one else there waiting. So I want to thank our presenter tonight, David, and to Ms. McIver for coming in and making her comments. Closed and move on to the next thing on the agenda. So next at number 9 of our agenda, deputations and presentations. I believe we have a presentation from our Director of Corporate Services with regard to the 2021 budget. Ms. Allen, oh, there you are, coming in live.
Thank you, Your Worship. I hope everyone can see this on your screen. I have a very short presentation just to coincide with the passing of the budget bylaw that is on tonight's agenda. As you'll recall, we had a public meeting at our last council and a presentation was done at that time. Tonight, we're bringing forward the budget bylaw. And we did extend the comment period for the last meeting to address the fact that we hadn't advertised on our website of the public meeting, although it was in the paper. That being said, there were no additional comments received between that meeting and the end of January when we extended the period too. So here we are with our final budget bylaw. There have been no changes to what was presented in that meeting in January. The total budget will ultimately set the levy, and the next step for council will be to make tax policy decisions in April. And then we'll start bringing you financial updates. Full year forecasts will start in May, but between now and then, I'll be able to provide you some specific COVID-related financial impacts as part of the city manager's COVID reports. So as I said, there are no changes to the overall budget from what was presented back in January. However, as a reminder, we are estimating a combined increase of 1.85%. This works out to a total of $72.43 on the average household, which is assessed at $220,000. Of that $72, $55 relates to the municipal levy. So our budget is adding about $4.56 to the average homeowner per month next year, or this year, I suppose, at this point. This chart just shows how the breakdown of the total taxes paid for that average household would go to the county school and to the city, and then the breakdown further for those city services, with roughly half going to core services and half going to the police and fire, the balance for capital and debt. This is a slide that I did think about putting in. I'm surveying other treasurers in the municipality, or in Gray County, I should say, for where they stand with their budgets and what their total levy increases are. So I don't want to spend too much time sort of going through all of the individual numbers, because each of these municipalities are at a different stage in approving their budgets, and some of these could very much still be draft figures. But it does give you an idea of how we compare as far as the total levy increase. So not taking growth into consideration, not taking the county and school into consideration, but just comparing how does our budget change over last year's budget. The city is at 2.76%. And as you can see, that is the lowest in Gray County, including the county itself. So with that, there really is no other new information to present, and the bylaw is included for your consideration and ultimately to be passed on tonight's agenda.
Great. Thank you very much for that update. That's good news, because we end up a little bit less when we get combined than what we thought 2 weeks ago, with the county coming down just a little bit. So 1.85 is pretty amazing. 1% guaranteed increase going to capital and infrastructure, which is good, and then pretty close to the cost of living increase. So we've done well. Thank you. Well, and I guess this is, if we're passing the bylaw, this is usually, Kate, this is usually where we say thank you to Ms. Allen and Mr. Simmons and all staff that would have started this back in about June. I don't know when the process starts, so way back in the summer, and then it comes and you know, it's well massaged before it ever comes to council in November. So we pass along our appreciation to all staff, to Ms. Allen and her staff that have put this together and worked at it and chipped away at the corners and got it to that amazing number that it's at. I think this is one of our best in a number of years, and certainly judging the last 2 or 3 years, we've been better than a lot of our comparators, comparative municipalities, for 3 or 4 years. This is just even better. As others increase and catch up to us, it gets us more into the middle without trying to cut major services that people use. So this is good news. Thank you. Public question period. Ms. Bloomfield, did we receive any questions?
No questions were received. Thank you.
Great. Thank you. We're at number 11, correspondence received for which direction the council is required. And that is the Owen Sound Downtown Improvement Area's budget.
Thank you, Worship. The 2021 Owen Sound Downtown Improvement Area budget was presented to the OSDIA board on December 9th, 2020, at which time the board directed staff to proceed to schedule a public meeting for the public to provide feedback on the proposed budget. The OSDIA held a public budget meeting on January 13th, 2021. No one registered to participate in the public meeting and no comments were received on the budget. As such, the board directed staff to forward the budget to council for final approval, and it has been included in the agenda package for council's review. While the Municipal Act requires business improvement areas to hold at least one public meeting to consider its budget prior to the budget being forwarded to council for final approval, it is worth noting that there are no requirements in the Act for BIAs or DIAs to hold an annual general meeting in order to pass a budget. If council is satisfied with the 2021 OSDIA budget, a motion will be needed to approve the budget as presented.
Great, thank you. Councillor Koepke, go ahead.
Thank you, Your Worship. I'll move that in consideration of the memo dated February 8th, 2021 from the Deputy Clerk respecting the 2021 Owen Sound Downtown Improvement Area Board of Management budget, City Council approves the budget as presented.
Great, thank you. Are there any questions from council? Any comments? I am seeing none, so I will call the question. Going through the list, in favor or opposed, Councillor Dodd?
In favor.
Councillor Gregg?
In favor.
Councillor Hamley?
In favor.
Councillor Koepke?
In favor.
Councillor Merton?
In favor.
Deputy Mayor O'Leary?
In favor.
Councillor Tamming?
In favor.
Councillor Thomas?
In favor.
Good, that's carried. Thank you. We're down to number 12A, which is report from facilities booking coordinator with regard to Owen Sound Little Theater request to waive rental fees. Ms. Coulter, go ahead.
Thank you, Worship. Back in October, Kathleen Murphy and Mike Tettenborn had made a presentation on behalf of the Owen Sound Little Theater to council regarding an initiative to present live outdoor performances at Kelso Beach Park in the summer of 2021. The idea would be they would recover lost revenue from 2020, increasing the capacity at an outside venue, allowing for social distancing. It really is a terrific idea. They asked council to consider waiving the fee for the park rental, and council requested staff bring back a report. They're proposing 10 shows on 9 different days. One day would offer an afternoon and evening performance between July 12th and 21st. As outlined in the report, the fee for the park on those days, each day would be about $158 per rental, which is the nonprofit rental rate for the park. The city does have a policy, CS37, which deals with the waiving of facility rental fees for uses where they're donating 100% of the profits to a city capital project or program. In this case, the use does not meet the policy. However, council may still consider waiving the fee. Kelso Beach Park hosts a number of large events each year and many smaller events, weddings, family picnics, and other events, birthday parties. As mentioned, there is a fee, a nonprofit fee, as well as a commercial rate, and the nonprofit fee has been reduced in an effort to support nonprofits' use of the park. The fee reflects the cost of providing and maintaining the space for all our users. There's several ways outside of the request that the city can support this event, including social media, a placement on our events calendar, and then providing things like recycling carts, garbage cans, and barricades for the event. While Owen Sound Little Theater should really be commended for this creative idea, which is kind of an invention of necessity in this world, staff cannot recommend the waiver of the fees at this time. And the recommendation, Your Worship, is that council would receive the report
and that you would deny the request to forgive the facility rental, and that you would ask staff to work with Little Theater to promote the event in the ways outlined, and any other ideas in the report.
Great, thank you. Council. Councilor Hamley?
Yeah, I would just move the recommendation, Your Worship.
Councilor Gregg, go ahead. Sorry, I didn't have my mic on, I guess.
Thank you, Mayor Boddy. I won't support that recommendation or that's been put on the floor. I think this is something that, as it was mentioned, is born by necessity. The Own Sound Little Theater is a vital, cultural, iconic type of organization in our downtown. You always hear lots of claimants throwing out numbers in terms of economic spinoff and financial spinoff that their organizations or businesses generate. This is actually one that has tremendous financial spinoff in our downtown. As we've worked through COVID, multiple layers of government, you know, they at the provincial level, it's seen right now, their support programs, they're trying not to layer grant programs and benefit programs on top of one another, and you're trying to fill cracks. Waiving the fees in this instance is not layering programs on top of programs. It's trying to fill a crack. The Little Theater is trying just to find an alternative revenue source in extreme times, extreme challenging times. There's no guarantee even by this summer that that things will be terrifically positive and we can get together in large numbers. I mean, if that's in an instance like this, we can't even guarantee weather one day out. So they could be impacted by poor weather in terms of their turnout. They could be impacted by COVID restrictions. I think, you know, in the last 12 months, as councillors have been scratching our heads in ways that we can help our community in small ways here and there. We've considered what we can do, what we can't do. We've looked at other federal programs that are in place. Here's an instance where we can provide a small benefit to the Own Sound Little Theater to attempt to assist them in having a productive, beneficial Shakespeare in the Park summer play. So I'm in favor of waiving the fees. I think it's something that the financial spinoff through our downtown, through restaurants primarily, because of the nature of what the Roxy and the Little Theater generate, it warrants it in this case.
Thank you. Any other comments? Seeing none, I will call the question. In favor or opposed, Councillor Dodd?
In favor.
Councillor Gregg?
Opposed.
Councillor Hamley?
In favor.
Councillor Koepke?
In favor.
Councillor Merton?
Opposed.
Deputy Mayor O'Leary?
In favor.
Councillor Tamming?
Opposed.
Councillor Thomas?
In favor.
So that is carried. Next at 12B, we have a report from the intermediate planner with regard to site plan approval for St. Mary's Rectory redevelopment. Ms. Coulter, go ahead.
Thank you, Worship. This is an application for site plan approval, as you mentioned, by the Roman Catholic Episcopal Corporation for a triangular property with an area of about 1.6 hectares that has frontage on 15th Street East, 16th Street East, as well as 6th Avenue East. The application is for site plan approval to facilitate the demolition of the existing rectory and the construction of a new one-story 423 square meter rectory. The existing rectory is a structure designated under Part 4 of the Ontario Heritage Act, and Community Services Committee, in their capacity as Municipal Heritage Committee, had consented to the demolition of the existing rectory back in December of 2019. Those minutes were approved by Council. The conditions of approval stated that a demolition permit could not be issued until there was site plan approval for the rectory reconstruction. In keeping with the conditions of demolition, a number of supporting documents were submitted together with the site plan approval application. They included the standard things like a site plan and landscape plan, but in this case, notably, were the demolition and new construction strategy, the architectural control guidelines, as well as the geotechnical review. In terms of the provincial policy statement, the new rectory is proposed as a one-story building, which will be clad in a brick veneer that closely matches the color of the red brick used on the church, and it will be subordinate to the church in terms of size and placement on the site. The proposed rectory does not obstruct the views or propose or detract from the prominence of the 1871 sanctuary, which is a landmark on the designated site. The rectory design does not impair the heritage character of the overall site, and the redevelopment of this property within the urban settlement area on full services is sympathetic to the site's heritage designation and is consistent with the provincial policy statement. As I mentioned, the heritage impact study had noted that the soil and the impact of the tree removal was a concern. With this in mind, there was a geotechnical study submitted, and the geotechnical study concluded that the soils were stable. In the end, the revised design, a somewhat smaller rectory, will now only see one tree removed instead of the original, I believe it was six, that were to be removed. The architectural control guidelines, the document and the it has documented and commemorated the history of the original rectory, and it will ensure that the new rectory respects the heritage character of the site. There will be a new landscape wall using the old brick, as well as a hard surface terrace using those recovered materials. In terms of the zoning bylaw, the proposed site plan meets or exceeds the minimum requirements of the zoning bylaw. The plan was also presented to Accessibility Advisory Committee on January 26th, and the committee has recommended approval of the plan, but asked that staff work with the developer to explore strengthening the internal pedestrian connection to either 16th Street and or 6th Avenue East. With that, Your Worship, the recommendation is that council would approve the site plan by GM Demert, that you would ask staff to bring forward a bylaw to authorize the mayor and clerk to execute the site plan and servicing agreements and other items for implementing site plan approval for 554 15th Street East, and that you would now permit staff to issue two heritage permits for the demolition of the existing rectory, as well as the reconstruction of the new rectory through the staff delegated heritage permit process. The site plan would be according to the conditions outlined in Schedule F.
Great, thank you. So I'm seeking a motion. Councillor Kepke.
Thank you, Your Worship. I'm happy to move the recommendation.
Okay, discussion, comments, questions? Seeing none, so I will call the question again. Councillor Dodd.
In favor.
Councillor Gregg.
In favor.
Councillor Hamley.
In favor.
Councillor Kepke.
In favor.
Councillor Burton.
In favor.
Deputy Mayor O'Leary.
In favor.
Councillor Tamming.
In favor.
And Councillor Thomas.
In favor.
So that is carried. Flipping the page over to 12C, Manager of Planning and Heritage again, evaluation process and notice of intention to dispose of the historic courthouse and jail properties. Go ahead, ma'am.
Thank you, Worship. In the late fall, Council had approved a recommendation from Community Services Committee, which was really a culminating report respecting the courthouse and jail, which addressed the next steps. To recap, you received and accepted the conclusion of the cultural heritage evaluation as well as the heritage impact assessment. Council and committee chose option one, which was to remove the governor's residence and the miscellaneous outbuildings. We gave notice of that decision, and you also asked us to reinitiate the process to dispose of the property, this time identifying the RFP as the preferred method of disposition. The city's land sale bylaw outlines procedures relating to the sale of land, and we have a table in the report that outlines those for you. Council had declared these lands surplus in 2014, so that's complete. There will be a new notice of our intention to dispose of the land, noting that the method of disposition will be by the RFP. It would be in the Sun-Times on our website as well. We're proposing two signs be posted on the property. In addition, we'll ensure that that notice gets to all of those who have indicated an interest in the purchase of the property. The staff report had stated that we would use the RFP as the proposed method for disposition, and staff was remiss in adding that the recommendation formally for committee and council approval include that detail. So what we're proposing is a cross-functional team of staff. They would score and then bring forward to council those higher scoring proposals. Those groups or individuals would be offered a tour of the facility, and then they would make a presentation to council of their vision and redevelopment vision for the site. So, Your Worship, the recommendation is that you would receive the report and that staff would proceed with the process as outlined in Table 1 of the report.
Great. Thank you. Motion first. Either.
Yeah, I would move the recommendation and maybe just ask the director first. This is very much just a housekeeping report, correct? There's no new actions being taken. We're just following the procedure that was set out already?
That's exactly correct.
Okay, perfect. Great.
Any other questions or comments from councillors? Seeing none, I'll call the question. Councillor Dodd.
In favor.
Councillor Gregg.
In favor.
Councillor Hamley.
In favor.
Councillor Koepke. Councillor Merton.
In favor.
Deputy Mayor O'Leary.
In favor.
Councillor Tamming.
In favor.
Councillor Thomas.
In favor.
So that is carried. We're down to 12D, report from Deputy Clerk with regard to public appointments to Committee of Adjustments. Go ahead.
Thank you, Your Worship. At the December 14th, 2020 Council meeting, City Council directed staff to bring forward a bylaw to appoint certain public members to boards and committees for specified terms. At the time, one vacancy remained on the Committee of Adjustment. During the January 18th, 2021 closed session, Council directed staff to bring forward an open report and bylaw to appoint Brian Green to the Committee of Adjustment for a term ending November 14, 2020. The appointment bylaw is being presented at the same meeting as the staff report to have the new member appointed prior to the February 16, 2021 Committee of Adjustment hearing. The recommendation listed for approval in the report is to direct staff to bring forward a bylaw to amend the board and committee bylaw to appoint Brian Green to the Committee of Adjustment with a term beginning immediately and ending November 14, 2022. With that, Your Worship, I'd be happy to take any questions.
Great. Thank you. Motion, go ahead.
Thank you, Your Worship. I'll move the recommendation.
And questions or comments from council? Seeing none, I'll call the question. Councillor Dodd.
In favor.
Councillor Gregg.
In favor.
Councillor Hamley.
In favor.
Councillor Koepke.
In favor.
Councillor Merton.
In favor.
Deputy Mayor O'Leary.
In favor.
Councillor Tamming.
In favor.
Councillor Thomas.
In favor.
So that carries. Thank you. 12E, Director of Corporate Services, dedication of gas tax funds. Ms. Allen.
Thank you. Yeah, thank you, Your Worship. I'm just pulling that up here. This is an annual report authorizing the mayor and clerk to enter into an agreement with the Minister of Transportation. Provincial gas tax, unlike federal gas tax, is dedicated solely for public transit. And it ensures that the City of Owen Sound can continue to provide a transit service that is affordable by its users and sustainable to the taxpayer. The combination of provincial gas tax, our safe restart funding, and the municipal transit cleaning funds will ensure that public transit service continues operating at a normal level even in the COVID situation, without any additional burden on the City of Owen Sound taxpayer. Our total grant for the 2021 fiscal year is approximately $245,000. This is consistent with the amount that we received in 2020, as well as with the amount that is in our budget.
Great, thank you.
I will move that recommendation, Your Worship.
Councillors, any questions or comments? Seeing none, I will call the question. Councillor Dodd?
In favor.
Councillor Gregg?
In favor.
Councillor Hamley? Councillor Merton?
In favor.
Deputy Mayor O'Leary?
In favor.
Councillor Tamming?
In favor.
And Councillor Thomas?
In favor.
So that is carried. 12F, Director of Corporate Services with regard to Owen Sound Housing Company Construction Finance Loan. Ms. Coulter. Oh, no, I missed. It's back to Ms. Allen.
That's actually my report, and we are hoping to pull this report from tonight's agenda. You may know, or I'm sure you do, as you're on that committee, but at County Council, this report was presented last week. However, there have been some changes proposed from the Owen Sound Housing Corporation that would change the terms of the loan agreement. So the county is actually going to revisit their recommendation at the next meeting. And then following that, I'll bring forward a new report that mirrors the decision and the final outcome of the county. So we're just going to press pause here for a moment, if that's okay.
So you've withdrawn it, so there's no action. That's and thank you for the information. Thanks. So next we're jumping to 12G, which is the verbal report from Deputy Mayor O'Leary with regard to Gray County Council and I guess two reports, Graybridge Board of Health. Go ahead.
I'll be giving that report on behalf of the Deputy Mayor tonight, Your Worship.
Thank you.
There is no report from County Council. But I do have something here from the Graybridge Health Unit. Just the latest stats on COVID-19, of course, as of February 7th, yesterday, a total of 663 cases in total over the past year in Gray and Bruce. There are presently 22 active cases. But the good news is there are zero long-term care retirement homes, zero schools, and zero daycares with outbreaks. And that to me is great news in terms of what's going on in our region. There are two more shipments of vaccine confirmed for our region towards the end of this month. So that is getting moving, and the health unit continues with its regular business as well, of course, on top of COVID. And most notably, they're still working on the opioid crisis, which perhaps we don't hear so much about right now, but we're all certainly keenly aware around this table, virtually or otherwise, that it does go on. They are commenting on the fact that the new Sharps disposal unit has been installed in downtown Owen Sound, and that trial is underway, and their needle exchange programs, naloxone distribution, and regular opioid working groups continue. So with that, I'll close it out. Thanks, Your Worship.
So Councillor Thomas, you're moving to receive your verbal report?
Well, sure.
And so all, well, I assume I should ask, there any questions first? Seeing none, I will therefore ask the call the question. Councillor Dodd?
In favor.
Councillor Gregg? Councillor Hamley?
In favor.
Councillor Kepke?
In favor.
Councillor Merton?
In favor.
Deputy Mayor O'Leary?
In favor.
Councillor Tamming?
In favor.
Councillor Thomas?
In favor.
So that carries. So that gets us through the reports, and we're down to the consent agenda at number 13. Ms. Bloomfield, go ahead.
Through you, Your Worship, on the consent agenda this evening is minutes for receipt from the Library Board, Owen Sound Housing Company, Owen Sound Municipal Nonprofit Housing Corporation, and the Police Board. Business licenses were issued to CC Variety Good Vibes at 271 9th Street East, Bark and Perfect Mobile Pet Grooming Services at 1348 7th Ave East, and Sealy Carpentry at 375 2nd Ave East. Lastly, the information package is available at 13G.
Thank you.
Moved by myself that City Council receives item 13A to 13G on the consent agenda dated February 8th, 2021.
Great. Thank you, Councillor Dodd.
In favor.
Councillor Gregg.
Favor.
Councillor Hamley.
In favor.
Councillor Koepke.
In favor.
Councillor Merton.
In favor.
Deputy Mayor O'Leary.
In favor.
Councillor Tamming.
In favor.
Councillor Thomas.
In favor.
So that carries. Now, if I can go back through that agenda, Councillor Thomas, anything to report from North Grey Union Library, I guess, November 26th.
No, thanks, Your Worship. Those are from November, and really, there's nothing I want to report out of those minutes. You've heard it all already.
Great, thank you. Councillor Merton, I see three sets of minutes from Housing. Anything to report?
Through Your Worship, and I think Brianna may have some images to show as well as I discuss. So the minutes I will address under B, C, and D are there for receipt. You will notice we wanted to celebrate the success. In the middle of COVID-19, we thought having some good news about affordable housing coming to our city was something we wanted to celebrate. So you will see that we're still building, and this is where we are to date. Even in the middle of the pandemic, the walls are going up and the foundations are getting secure. The board also wanted to express a sincere thank you to the city staff for all of their assistance in this new build, but most particularly to extend a sincere thank you to the building department, especially Kevin Linthorne and Wesley Wright, who attend the site meeting. Sorry, the site minutes and have the meetings. Their guidance has been absolutely instrumental in helping us continue to this point, and the board has asked that thank you be forwarded to them. So this is the information around the new build, and unless there are questions, it's for receipt.
Great, thank you. Does anyone, any of the councillors have any questions for Councillor Merton?
It's Scott here. Through the mayor, I just wanted to thank Councillor Merton for the image that she's presented tonight. This is actually just located west of 9th Avenue East and slightly north of 20th Street. It's actually in an area of the city where a lot of people don't travel unless perhaps they're inclined to be residents of Malleable Hill subdivision. But there's been a lot of positive development go on up there in the last couple of years with the nonprofit housing. And this is just the latest step. But this is something when people are out walking, this is something for sure to venture up towards the French School, École Saint-Dominique, and just check out the project that Councillor Merton was alluding to earlier. It's very impressive. So thanks for putting the image up.
Thank you to Brianna. Thank you, Scott.
Push the button. Owen Sound Police Services Board, Councillor Koepke.
Thank you, Your Worship. Given that these minutes are from November, I'm presuming that Councillor Tamming won't mind if I give a summary of these minutes, since he would not have attended this particular meeting. There's a couple of points in this meeting that I'd like to bring to the attention of council. An independent consultant is being engaged by the Ministry of the Solicitor General Public Safety Division to conduct a review of the funding framework for court security and prisoner transportation. The city of Owen Sound is unique in that our police services board is the location of the Grey County Courthouse, which is legislated through Section 137 of the Police Services Act, and we are responsible for court security and prisoner transportation, with these costs falling to the Owen Sound Police Service Board and the City of Owen Sound taxpayers, even though the courthouse serves the majority of Grey County and a large portion of Bruce County and handles all matters from Tobermory through South Bruce Peninsula and all of Grey County, with the exception of West Grey, Hanover, and half of the town of Blue Mountains. With approximately 83,000 people being served by a Grey County court, costs are covered only by those taxpayers in Owen Sound. Owen Sound Police Service Board currently receives a provincial grant in the amount of approximately $422,000 to assist with paying these costs. However, we are still left with a $282,000 shortfall. In fact, during 2020 and the COVID-19 situation, the current system requires that due to staffing prisoners be handled at the Owen Sound Police Service rather than the Gray County Lockup Facility, and this will actually increase court security costs for 2021. Court security costs were to be offset by increased revenue from provincial offenses courts and are administered by the County of Gray on behalf of Gray and Bruce counties, and therefore any revenue generated from fines is shared amongst all municipalities. With the courthouse being located in Owen Sound, only Owen Sound taxpayers cover these costs, while all other municipalities served by the courts are not required to contribute to these costs. Owen Sound Police Services and Chief Ambrose have made a presentation to the review committee and met also with Minister Walker to express our uniqueness and concerns, and the results of this review will be released in the near future. The other item discussed at the meeting was receipt of the presentation from the Community Safety and Well-being Committee and the plan, which is in its final stages prior to presentation to the Ministry of the Solicitor General. The plan is a joint plan for all municipalities in Gray and Bruce counties, with the exception of the municipality of Meaford. Thank you.
Oh, any questions for Councillor Koepke? Seeing none, I just want to take this point. Councillor Koepke has represented us as councillors on the police board for the past 2 years, and as we all know, it is changing. She's been a very strong member of that police board and very appreciated by all of them with the constructive manner that she brought to the committee and in representing council and the city's interests. So we thank her for the 2 years of our representation. With that, is anyone else have any comments with regard to the consent agenda? I'm seeing none. We'll go to committee minutes for with recommendation for approval, starting with accessibility advisory.
Yes, Your Worship. The two big ticket items at the last accessibility committee meeting were the St. Mary's Rectory redevelopment and the Sydenham campus redevelopment, which has been very well talked about this evening. So I would just move the recommendation, or I would move receipt of the report.
Actually, we're moving the report and recommendations for approval. Councillor Dodd.
All right, in favor.
Councillor Gregg.
Sure.
Councillor Hamley.
In favor.
Councillor Koepke.
In favor.
Councillor Merton.
In favor.
Deputy Mayor O'Leary.
In favor.
Councillor Tamming.
In favor.
Councillor Thomas.
In favor.
And that's carried. And I didn't really ask before that if there's any questions for Councillor Hamley with regard to those minutes. Seeing none. Okay, next we have minutes from Community Services Committee meeting held on January 20th. That's you. Go ahead.
Thank you, Your Worship. January 20th, 2021, Community Services Committee. The committee received a report from staff regarding a summary of the official plan update and open house and a special meeting of council, which will take place on March 15th, 2021. Members of the public that wish to speak are asked to pre-register on the city's website by March the 5th, with their comments being received by March 15th. A facade and structural improvement application was recommended to be granted for 1000 First Avenue West, known as the Pollock Home, for a double facade grant, which is 50% of the costs up to a maximum of $7,500. The facilities booking coordinator provided an update on the 2021 recreation fall and winter programs in line with provincial regulations due to COVID-19. Building statistics were provided indicating the successes of 2020, with nearly $700,000 in building permit fees being collected, with a construction value of nearly $66.5 million. A summary of the heritage permits issued for 2020 was received for information. This is a brief summary, Your Worship, and with that, I would move approval of these minutes.
Great, thank you. Now, are there any questions? Not seeing any, I will call the question. Councillor Dodd.
In favor.
Councillor Gregg.
Favor.
Councillor Hamley.
In favor.
Councillor Koepke.
Favor.
Councillor Merton.
In favor.
Deputy Mayor O'Leary.
In favor.
Councillor Tamming.
In favor.
Councillor Thomas.
In favor.
So those are carried. So 14C are minutes of the Corporate Services Committee meeting held on January 28th.
Thank you, Worship. We received a very good letter from a member of the public regarding the bid evaluation process for vehicle repairs and oil changes. In attendance, we had the manager of purchasing, risk, and asset management, and she noted that there were some areas of the city's RFP process that could be improved for future clarity and transparency to potential vendors for the future bids. The committee made a motion that they review prior to renewal, that it's brought back to committee. Any further discussion on that matter? We received another report, just that this is just a biannual report regarding the awarded tenders and proposals between projects or capital items purchased between $50,000 and $250,000. We received a report. This is actually a quite exciting one. You'll see the director of corporate services is going to get really excited about this one. We're creating the map of the geomatics of map for 2021, which will highlight the capital projects. And I see Matthew has jumped in as well, so maybe he might be able to provide a little more insight. But this is actually a pretty neat project. And the purpose of the project is to increase engagement and communication with members of the public in terms of capital budget projects. So we always hear about how many projects we have on the go and where they are. And this will actually create a map, and members of the public and members of council will have easy access to access this map and be able to see what kind of capital projects are going on and where they're going on within the city. And you'll be able to actually update it. So if when Dennis, instead of doing Dennis on the road of telling us how the 10th Street Bridge was going, you'd be able to look at the map and be able to see what kind of stage you're at with that capital project. So users will be able to view information such as the project name, budget, estimated completion date, and a project detail sheet. And then also that map will be updated on a regular basis throughout the year. So that way to also include photos of projects as they progress as well. So it's a really good transparency tool, and I'm really excited to see how that goes. The director of corporate services is also very excited to see how that goes. And as that goes on, we'll be able to add to that. And it's neat that that's just something that we're doing within our own services. Next, we received a report from the manager of purchasing, risk, and asset management regarding self-contained breathing apparatuses for the fire department. So we approved that to go with 3M Scott Fire and Safety. We received another report. We have our clerk on the call as well. So if you have any questions for this report in particular regarding election 2022 voting methods, it's hard to believe that next year we're already into another municipal election and having that discussion. However, during all of this, we have to, council needs to make a decision on which route we're going for voting methods. So the clerk's department put together a fantastic presentation that was passed along to members of council earlier today. And I'm sure it's going to be added to the minutes of this meeting to be included for future reference. It highlighted the pros and cons of each potential voting options, whether it was the internet/telephone, mail, paper combination. We did have the manager of legislative services note that measures have been put in place by providers to ensure similar issues regarding the delays that we had experienced in the 2018 election will not occur again in the future. Obviously, we were aware that it was something that happened, and it was obviously a concern of many individuals that we had to press pause for a couple of days. So it gave a little bit of dramatics to that election. The city clerk also confirmed in the last election, approximately 15% of voters utilized help centers. So with that, meaning individuals came to a help center and were able to, with assistance, be able to use the systems to be able to make their voting. So that's a good number to note that even if they were doing internet and telephone voting, that there still is an option for some individuals to go to a help center to do in person. The city clerk assured the committee that the data from the voter list would be cleaned up. That was also another concern in the past, and validated as much as possible. The city is also going to be partnering with MPAC for a voter lookup program that will allow individuals to verify that they are actually on the voter list. So with that, the committee did recommend that council move forward with authorizing internet and telephone voting as the voting method for 2022. And as I noted, that in that presentation, there was a number of pros that went along with that. And I'm just going to read a little bit with them. With internet and telephone pros, it supports the public health protocols, as we have to take into consideration of what's actually, what kind of world are we going to be living in 2022. At this time, when we are planning, we're planning that we need to be in the safest position that we can be. And internet and telephone voting does meet that goal. It's mostly accessible, the most accessible option to include individuals with help centers and being able to do it through telephone and internet. It's accurate. You're not worrying about actual individual voting. It's all going to be tabulated itself. It's the resulting in the quickest results. We heard a lot of comments in our official plan about going green and making sure that we're incorporating green initiatives for our official plan. And internet and telephone actually hits that need of being in the greenest option. And also, it is also the least expensive option for the voting methods. So, as I noted, council, our committee supported that. All public members, we were very interested in seeing what the public members, on their perspective, and all the public committee members expressed support for the idea. Noting cost savings, reliability, and the speeds of results as positive factors. And finally, we also received a report regarding our video surveillance policy. This was just an update, and we're adopting the revised video surveillance policy. And with that, Your Worship, I'll move approval of these minutes.
Great, thank you. So I guess maybe first we'll ask, does anyone have questions with regard to the election question, the decision made? Councillors, Greg.
Thanks, Mayor Boddy. Just wondering if it could be expanded upon how the voter rolls, the cards and so forth have been cleaned up, so that we're trying to improve upon what occurred a couple of years ago, where individuals display five different voter registration cards on their kitchen table. And you know, we think the best of everyone and know that they won't vote illegally. However, it was a problem 2 years ago. The electoral lists were not good, and you spoke to some improvements, but I'm just wondering if that could be expanded upon a little bit more as to how and what has improved for that, for the voter registration list.
Ms. Bloomfield has the answer for that.
Through Your Worship, to Councillor Gregg, thank you for the question. As a clerk staff, we do everything that we can to improve the voters list, such as removing duplicates and those we've been notified who have passed away once we receive that list from MPAC. And we do that throughout the 4 year period. As well, we will partner with MPAC to encourage voters to check the voters list. And in fact, they can even be doing that now with going on to MPAC and checking to see if you're on the voters list and then making any corrections that may be needed to ensure that the mail outs go to the right owner. And we will do the voter lookout through our website and advertise through media releases. And I should also mention that there is light at the end of the tunnel. There have been some concerns expressed through the MPAC voters list, but we will be moving to an Elections Ontario list in the next municipal election, which will take effect in 2026.
Okay, further questions?
So if I could just follow up, there was a working group, I believe, created after the last municipal election to work on the electoral list. Did anything become of that, and it was part of the cleaning up and the improvements that the clerk noted?
Through your worship, my understanding is that that working group basically led to us moving towards using the Ontario or the list through Elections Ontario rather than through MPAC.
Okay. Any other questions? Nothing on the voting system. Okay. Are there any questions with regard to the mapping? Seeing. Is there Travis, is there a presentation, Matthew, or?
I'm not aware, but I think Matthew might be there just to answer any questions that anyone from council that may have regarding that mapping. I know we should be very proud of what that is. So if anyone does have any questions about it, I'm sure Matthew would be quite happy to answer those for you.
Okay, any questions? Again, I'm seeing none. So Matthew, you're off the hook. Thank you very much for attending and for the work that you do. Thanks. So with that, I will call the question with regard to the recommendations for approval of the entire minutes. Councillor Dodd?
In favor.
Councillor Gregg?
In favor.
Councillor Hamley?
In favor.
Councillor Koepke?
In favor.
Councillor Merton?
In favor.
Deputy Mayor O'Leary?
In favor.
Councillor Tamming?
In favor.
Councillor Thomas?
In favor.
So that is carried. That gets us through our committee reports. Number 15, we have no postponed matters. Number 16, we have no motions. Discussion of additional business. Mr. Kafalas.
Thank you, Your Worship, and through you, Your Worship, just a little bit of an update of what went on over the weekend with all the snowfall that we experienced. According to the Weather Channel, we had 10 inches or 25 centimeters. I think that's a little light. I think Saturday morning alone, we had 3 inches in a span of just over an hour. So in order, you know, snow started on Friday, continued right up into Sunday. During Saturday, during the busiest time, we would had our regular crew on from 8 to 4, but we asked some of the midnight crew to stay on until noon to help deal with the issue with the snow that was continuously falling. And in the afternoon, we asked the afternoon shift to come in for around noon to help out and do some overtime to help us keep the roads in fairly good shape, especially arterials and the collectors. You may have noticed the buses were operating without any major delays, essentially on schedule. So that was a good thing. We had our 4 plows going on Saturday morning and 1 front end loader and 2 of the sidewalk plows, but it was hard. You know, the sidewalk plows are equipped with blowers and especially during the morning period where it was still continuously snowing, no sooner they get the sidewalks cleared off and then they'd have to go right back and do the same sidewalks. So you'll find that that's what happens essentially too with all the major roads and the hills, is that no sooner we get those done and then they have to be done again. So they're, you know, you can't really get to the class 4s and 5s and 6s, which are the cul-de-sacs, until we really get a good handle on the major roads throughout the community. You know, Sunday came, the snow had stopped. You know, we went out and did tours. Our superintendent was in on both days, Saturday and Sunday. You know, driving around, you can see that most of the roads were done. There was a couple of class 5 that still had to be done in the cul-de-sacs, but the majority were done. So we did have a very good handle on it by the end of Sunday. And this morning we had the 4 sidewalk plows equipped with blowers out and about town to try and clean up the sidewalks as best we can with the having all equipment at our disposal. And again, you know, with the sidewalk plows, when they're equipped with the blowers, they can only travel to 2 to 3 kilometers an hour. So it does take time, but the guys stay hard at it. And I think overall we responded fairly well, quite well, in fact, to deal with that snowfall we experienced over the weekend.
That's great, Mr. Kafalas. I wanted you to present that because you'd sent the email to us, and it's pretty amazing that everybody's on for extra shifts and all the equipment is going and how quickly they pulled it together, because that was a lot of snow that was coming down Friday night and Saturday at points. We were out walking to the market actually on Saturday morning and you couldn't even see up the block for the amount of snow that was coming. So Please pass along our appreciation to all the staff and the crew that came in and worked and got that job done over the weekend and the sidewalks this morning. They were in great shape. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
Councillor Merton.
Through your worship, I was grateful for the opportunity to have attended the Rural Ontario Municipal Association virtual conference, Connecting Rural Ontario, that was held online January 25th and 26th of this year. There were many interesting topics to choose from in the concurrent sessions, and the four that I selected, and these are the titles, I didn't make this up: Come Hell or High Water, Actions to Mitigate Flooding, Now What, An Open Conversation on Community Safety and Well-being Plans, The Pathway to Full Producer Responsibility of the Blue Box, and The Science Behind Implicit Bias. The information that was shared, the key messages, and the opportunity to connect with other rural municipalities was extremely helpful to me, and certainly as we move forward through COVID-19. As was stated by several speakers at the conference, we are stronger together, and I thank the city and the taxpayers for that opportunity to attend this conference. Thank you.
Okay, thank you for that update. Councillor Koepke.
Thank you, Your Worship. Just wanted to highlight an event that's taking place right now in Owen Sound. It's called Snow and Sound. And this is taking place at various locations in Owen Sound, which are highlighted. And participants can find out how to take place and take part in this through the city's website. So go on to the city's website and have a look and see how you can participate and find out more information on Snow and Sound. Thank you.
Great, thank you. It looks like lots of fun. So I've got a couple matters here. First of all, we welcome the announcement by Hydrogen Optimized on Friday. They announced they took a major step towards their goal of becoming a global leader in large-scale green hydrogen production systems by securing a new technology and manufacturing center in Owen Sound, which I think we all know by now is the former Tenneco building. The company's rugged cell water electrolysis system are targeted to major industry, chemical, utility, and energy end users, which represent the largest segment of an overall addressable green hydrogen market. Targets have already been established in Europe. The EU's hydrogen strategy aims for at least 40,000 megawatts of renewable hydrogen electrolyzers, there we go, by 2030. Major industries and governments have identified the use of green electricity with large-scale water electrolyzers as an essential contributor to achieving net zero carbon emissions by 2050. I've reached out to Hydrogen Optimized today and talked to Andrew Stewart and Ted Stewart. They were both very excited about being able to come to Owen Sound and talked about the network of hydrogen industry and focused industry that's going to grow in Grey-Bruce Huron. So we really look forward to having them here. This, of course, is not a smokestack. It's an industry that's going to provide jobs. It's going to provide cleaner air, cleaner environment as it goes forward, or a product that will do that. So we're pretty excited about it. I also want to take this opportunity to again thank Peter Van Dolder and his partners for their foresight and investment in our city, buying up the PPG building and then Tenneco. And for them, it's clearly more than just an investment. Keeping the industrial buildings local, the ownership local, they're making the best decisions in the best interest of our community as a priority, and it isn't just an investment to try and pull out lots of money. So we really appreciate those guys that are buying up this type of real estate and then finding ways to get tenants in there that are providing jobs and helping our economy. So it's very appreciated. Second, 2021 is the year of the ox. The Lunar New Year starts this Friday and goes 16 days, ending February 26th with the Lantern Festival. We wish happiness and prosperity for the coming year to our community, and to our friends in our twin city, Dai, China. Locally, the Grey Bruce Chinese Heritage and Cultural Association, Culture Association, will present the Grey Bruce Lunar New Year celebration to acknowledge the Lunar New Year. It's celebrated not only by mainland China, but also other countries. In Grey and Bruce, there are immigrants from Vietnam, Taiwan, and Singapore who also celebrate the New Year. So if you're down around downtown, look for the red, I guess you'd call them diamonds, with a stamp of the ox on it. The association is putting on their annual community art show again. They've done this for a number of years, but of course not being able to use the art gallery or the Grey Roots the same way that they would have. It's great to have it in stores that are open. Local artists are showing at various downtown businesses. Again, look for the red diamond printed on it and go into the stores and have a look. Do watch for activities at Grey Roots and Owen Sound Library, and there will be a virtual celebration this weekend. Look for the Grey Bruce Chinese Heritage and Culture Association on Facebook for best information. So I want to thank the organizations, the organizers for sharing their culture, as not only their culture, but they've done some great research on the depth of history of Asian residents in Owen Sound. It's pretty impressive. Of course, we can all learn from one another and be better for it. Also happening in February, of course, Canada is celebrating the 25th Black History Month in February. We celebrate and recognize the important contributions Black Canadians have made in shaping the development, heritage, and growth of our country, and specifically of our city. Black settlers started to arrive in what is now Grey County as early as 1820. Many were granted their freedom for fighting alongside the British in the War of 1812. That was well before the first surveyors, and then deeds were granted to mostly Scottish newcomers. And because so many of the Black community were already there, they didn't get their deeds and they weren't recognized, which was unfortunate 150 years ago. In 1872, 672 people of African ancestry had traveled to the village of Sydenham, now Owen Sound, through the Underground Railroad and called it home. That made up 10% of Owen Sound's population. Just one piece of our history, because there's lots. The historic British Methodist Episcopal Church was established in 1856 in Owen Sound. After meeting at four other locations, the church moved to its current location 110 years ago in February of 2011. Addie Aylstock was a deaconess at the BME Church in Owen Sound. In 1951, she became the first ordained woman minister of the BME, the first Black Canadian minister in Canada. She is one of many trailblazers that helped to shape our great city, province, and country. Of course, this summer, 2021, we look forward to marking the 159th year of the Emancipation Festival and Picnic at Harrison Park. It has happened every year since the British government enacted the Emancipation Act of 1862. A lot of the original, some that were escaped slaves, a lot of the original Black settlers, their children, grandchildren, great-grandchildren, I guess not their children by this point, but their offspring, return home to meet with family, listen to music, eat great food, and it's a wonderful event. So, whether, you know, looking at the Chinese festival or our Black heritage, it's really easy to be proud of our history here in Owen Sound. And together we continue to educate one another, share our unique stories, and strive for an inclusive Owen Sound, one that is free of racism and discrimination. And it's we've got so much to offer and can do that. So thanks. So those are the end of my additional business comments. Motion that the Committee of the Whole would rise.
Moved by myself that the committee of the whole rise and report.
And got to go through it. Councillor Dodd.
Favor.
Councillor Gregg.
In favor.
Councillor Hamley.
In favor.
Councillor Koepke.
In favor.
Councillor Merton.
In favor.
I'm going to skip past the Deputy Mayor O'Leary. Councillor Tamming.
In favor.
Councillor Thomas.
In favor.
Now I'll come back to Deputy Mayor O'Leary.
In favor.
That's carried. Thank you. So we're now back into formal session. So number 19.
Moved by myself, seconded by Councillor Koepke, that the action taken in Committee of the Whole in considering public meetings, deputations and presentations, public question period, matters arising from correspondence, reports of city staff, consent agenda, committee minutes, matters postponed, motions for which notice was previously given, and additional business be confirmed by this council.
Great. Thank you. Councillor Dodd.
In favor.
Councillor Gregg.
In favor.
Councillor Gregg. Yep. Okay. Just got a thumbs up. You can't hear him. Councillor Hamley.
In favor.
Councillor Koepke.
In favor.
Councillor Merton.
In favor.
Deputy Mayor O'Leary.
In favor.
Councillor Tamming.
In favor.
Councillor Thomas.
In favor.
Well, that one carries. Notices of motion. Does anyone have wish to give notice of motion? Future meetings, seeing none. Number 21 bylaws, Ms. Bloomfield.
Through your worship, the bylaws listed for approval on tonight's agenda include the confirmatory bylaw, a bylaw to execute a transfer payment agreement respecting municipal transit enhanced cleaning funding, a bylaw to amend the board and committee bylaw to appoint Brian Green to the committee of adjustment, a bylaw to approve the 2021 budget, and a bylaw to execute a second amending site plan agreement for St. Mary's Parish at 554 15th Street East.
Great, thank you.
Moved by myself, seconded by Councillor Koepke, that bylaw numbers 2021-13, 2021-14, 2021-15, 2021-16, and 2021-17 be passed and enacted.
Thanks, Councillor Dodd.
In favor.
Councillor Gregg.
In favor.
Councillor Hamley.
In favor.
Councillor Koepke.
In favor.
Councillor Merton.
In favor.
Deputy Mayor O'Leary.
In favor.
Councillor Tamming.
In favor.
Councillor Thomas.
In favor.
So that's carried. So that completes our business for tonight. It is 9:18 p.m. Thanks, everyone. We'll see you in a couple of weeks. Good night.
All.